This conference will now be recorded.
Okay. So let's first start with here. The agenda for the session, we are going to start discuss about the architectural overview of what is big data, and then what is the tool that we make use of for storing and processing what we call as big data, that is Hadoop, and its architecture perspective. So this is the agenda for today's session. So here we are going to introduce what are the characteristics which differentiate normal data versus big data. Then big data characteristics, because of its characteristics, why it doesn't fit into your traditional RDBMS. That means, what are all the capabilities of your RDBMS, and where RDBMS is lagging for storing and processing big data, then how the framework Hadoop, which is an open source framework, it overcomes the difficulties that RDBMS facing to handle big data in terms of its architecture perspective. What is the architecture of Hadoop? And Hadoop, it is not a single component. It forms a combination of several components, and what are all the associated ecosystem components. So these are all the agenda for the current session. Okay. So let me first start with what is big data. So big data is a generic term. It is not a specific term. It is a generic term, similar to that of your database or similar to that of RDBMS. So to be a layman point of view, so the today's digital information, okay, today's digital information, which is of very huge volume, is termed as big data, generically. Okay, so everywhere being it is computerized, whatever may be the domain, whether it starts from banking, insurance, healthcare, scientific explorations, everywhere, portfolio, everything, everywhere we have a computerized, everywhere we have automated, so everywhere we have sensors, IoTs, RFIDs, which in turn resulted in generation of a huge volume of data in terms of terabytes and petabytes. Okay, to accommodate this huge volume of data, your traditional RDBMS tools like Oracle, MySQL and SQL Server does not have that capability because of its certain restrictions in its architecture. And then what are all those restrictions that RDBMS faces? How those restrictions can be overcome by using Hadoop is going to be discussed. So let me start with what is big data. So big data, a generic definition is, it represents any data. The data may be a structured data or a semi-structured data, or it may be an unstructured data. If we take into consideration the data, here these are all the following three types of data. Okay, structured data, yes, semi-structured data and unstructured data. What is a structured data? So you guys recall the tables that we are making use of in your RDBMS. So you create a table employee with the following fields: employee number, employee name, and then job, and then salary. So here this thing has been well organized in forms of rows and columns, all your table. So you have employee number 1, employee name Ram, so job DBA, salary 9500, employee number 2, employee name Thuru, job architect, salary 10,000. So I can able to access any value here. If I want to access the Thiru, I can represent that it is a second row and it is a second column. So here, by a way of storing the data in a well-defined manner in forms of rows and columns, I can able to locate any information by specifying a row-column intersection. So this is the way by which your RDBMS stores data and do process on top of it. User will apply query and the query will do process on top of it and return back the needed result. This is an example of structured data. So if you consider today's digital data, only 20% of today's data is coming under structured data. The remaining 80% of data is coming either under a semi-structured or under an unstructured format. And what do you mean by semi-structured and what is unstructured? So here, if you take your documents, PDFs, documents in sense your PDF, your XML files, your emails, they may have some partial structure. They may not have a full structure as that of your table. They may have some partial structures. Okay, those sort of data has been termed as a semi-structured data. Unstructured data, your audio files, your video files, your images, okay, your still pictures, these are all some of the examples of unstructured data. So being everywhere has been computerized, everywhere you have a digital information. Almost 80% of today's data is coming under the category, whereas only 20% is coming under structured category, which your RDBMS possesses the support. You have your RDBMS won't have a direct support for handling a semi-structured or unstructured data, but it is accumulating into 80% of overall today's data. Then where you can go for? What is the reason behind RDBMS couldn't able to handle this semi-structured and unstructured data? That we will discuss. So now recall back. Then what is big data? It is a representation of any data, a semi-structured and unstructured data, which is beyond the storage and processing capability of a single centralized database server. This is the architecture currently followed by your traditional RDBMS. What this architecture will do? Here you have a one machine called as a server, where you have your database. Here only your data will be present. Then all the user, what they will do? They will interact with the server. They are all called clients. Okay, the user will send a query through the client machine. The client takes the query to the server, where it got processed and the result will be returned back. So here your data has been stored only on this single server. For example, imagine that the server's hard disk capacity is 2 terabyte. So you can at the maximum can able to store only 2 TB of data. If you want to store 5 TB of data, there is no provision here. Why? So because maximum capability the server can able to withstand as per as this example is 2 TB, that alone can be stored. You can't have another server with a 3 TB of a hard disk and split your data 2 TB here and 3 TB here in case of your RDBMS. You can have your database on a single server only, and that too is a centralized. That means you have multiple clients and all the client will have interaction to this server, and it will here only you have your all the data. Then the client will issue a query, and query will be taken to the server, it got processed and result will be returned back. So this is the architecture. Because of its limitation of storing data on a single server, so if you want to store a huge volume of data, that is not possible in your RDBMS. That is the reason, which is beyond the storage and processing. Being your data is stored on a single server, you are limited with the resources, microprocessor, you are limited with the RAM memory, you are limited with the hard disk that can be accommodated within the server. And because of the reason, since today's digital data, being the data that it is generated, is in a terabyte, is in petabyte, okay, etc., etc., you can't able to store and do process a terabyte and petabyte of data on this architecture. So that is the reason why we couldn't make a storage and processing in your traditional RDBMS architecture. Then your data, it may be a structure, semi-structure, unstructured, which is beyond the storage and processing capability of a single centralized database server architecture, which is currently followed by RDBMS, and more importantly, possessing the following four characteristics: volume, velocity, variety, and veracity. What is volume? The amount of data that we need to store is termed as volume. So here it starts with the terabyte, petabyte, zettabyte, etc., etc. For example, if we take Facebook, per day it is generating almost 500 terabytes of data per day. If you take Twitter, per day Twitter is generating around 250 terabytes of tweets per day. If you consider anything, for banking applications or weather forecasting. So here the weather forecasting applications here, want to find out the minimum temperature and maximum temperature of a particular state. In sense, it need to process not less than 100 dBs of data. For example, the weather forecasting for entire India, what's the minimum and maximum temperature recorded in India on today, Sunday? Then here we have a sensor that is fabricated across multiple locations. It may be in lakhs of number. So here you need to gather data from these sensors, and you need to store the data, and you need to apply the minimum and maximum, the programming logic on top of the data. So being there are around 1 lakh of sensors incorporated throughout India, then the data that is captured 24 hours on this sensor, starting from morning 1 to 24 night, and then need to be stored and need to be processed. So these are all some of the examples where today's environment, today's applications need to store and process data in terms of this opposite volume. So a big data is one, and which the amount of data, the volume of the data will be in terabytes and petabytes. The velocity, what is velocity? The rate at which the data is generated. The rate at which data is generated, speed of generation, is termed as velocity. For example, let you take a, you are going to hear, Amazon is going to launch a New Year's sale. Okay, here, from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m., if you purchase any product, so 40% offer. Then what happens if that is the scenario on Sunday? Okay, if you purchase any 10 to 11, then now here lakhs and lakhs of people will try to access to the Amazon web server. Here, the number of requests that approaches this Amazon web server will be in terabyte of requests per hour. Okay, that is the way by which you can define our velocity. Rate at which data is generated and approaching the server is termed as velocity. So here, in terms of your big data, if your application is going to receive a huge volume of data like the one the Amazon web server announcing a New Year percentage sale, here the volume of data that will be generating will be minimum terabyte per hour. Okay, so that is the minimum generation if you want to consider this as a big data. And third one, the variety. You have structured, you have semi-structured, and you have unstructured data. And fourth one, reliable. How far your data is reliable. That is termed as veracity. For example, so in your table, a employee table, if you have in your RDBMS, if you have defined your employee number as integer, you can't enter A01. Why so? Because so it won't permit a character. Similarly, if the employee number is declared as primary key, you can't enter a null value. Okay, you can't enter enter other value by excluding this employee number. So these are all some of the ways by which here you need to input only clear data. The data should not possess any anomalies. But if you take big data, you crawl data from these sensors, you crawl data from these social networking sites, you can't able to ensure clear data. The data may have some missing values, the data may have some inconsistencies, the data may have some irrelevant information, but these are all the characteristics associated with your big data. Your tool, which is used for storing and processing what we call as big data, should accommodate data with the opposite anomalies. Therefore, if we take into consideration the key characteristics of big data, in terms of the first character volume, it will be terabyte and petabyte. In terms of the rate at which it is generated, minimum terabyte per hour. In terms of variety, structure, semi-structure and unstructured. And in terms of veracity, the data may have missing value, it may be inconsistency, it may have irrelevant information. So these are all the four characteristics togetherly differentiate what is a big data and what it is a normal data. Okay, so is it making sense now? What is big data? If you have any doubt, please let me know. A generic term, a layman point of view, which represents today's digital data, which forms a structure, semi-structure and unstructured, which we couldn't, because of its huge volume and because of its very high generation speed, we couldn't able to accommodate on the traditional RDBMS. So we need a a separate infra to tackle this. We are going to discuss about this infra shortly. Is it making sense? Do you have any doubt? Radha and Rahu, please let me know. Purida?
Yes,
is it clear? Please talk little bit louder. Your voice was found to be very feeble. Please, I couldn't able to grasp what you are trying to convey to me. Yes, thanks. Okay. Now, let me recall what we discussed. So, big data is a term for collection of large and complex data sets that makes it difficult to store, process and analysis using the traditional RDBMS tools like Oracle, MySQL, SQL Server, and it is characterized by high velocity, volume and variety that requires special methods for storage and processing. சித்தப்பா அந்த கிளாஸ்ல இருக்கேன் சித்தப்பா, இன்னும் ஒரு அரை மணிநேரத்தில் முடிச்சுட்டு பேசுறேன். ஃபாரின் கிளாஸ் we can proceed further. So am I audible?
Yeah.
Now, so these are all the ways by which you can define a big data. Okay, so here if you make a difference, these are all the differences between RDBMS and the big data. Your volume. For RDBMS supports gigabytes and up to few terabytes. If your data size is up to few terabytes, 1 to 10 terabytes, then it is well and good to use RDBMS. Whereas big data starts with terabyte, petabyte, and it goes on zettabytes. In terms of velocity, for RDBMS support megabyte of data per hour. So here gigabyte of data per hour is then, whereas your big data starts with the generation is a terabyte of data per hour. Okay, variety, it support only structured data, whereas your big data support is a structured data. It need to have a semi-structure and unstructured data. All the three need to be accommodated. Veracity, you should have a clear data. That is, your data should not have no anomalies. It should not have missing value like thing. Whereas the data will have some anomalies. It may be inconsistent. It may have some missing values. It may have some irrelevant information. So your tool should able to accommodate all those things. Then most important difference in terms of database architecture, it is a centralized database architecture. Whereas here this big data is one, it is a distributed database architecture. And finally, in terms of infra, it is a client server or RDBMS, but this is a master slave architecture. We will discuss the two important things, database and infra. Okay, let me start the infra. So these are all the ways by which you can differentiate your traditional RDBMS versus the infra that you are going to use for big data. Okay, now what is the tool that you are going to use for storing and processing big data if not your RDBMS? Here there is a tool by name Data Appliances. What is Data Appliances? Data Appliances is nothing but it is a combination of higher end hardware plus customized software. You have higher end servers with a customized software containing multiple CPUs, that is multiple microprocessors, more amount of RAM memory, more storage capacity, higher end servers, okay, which you can use to store and process what we call as big data. Examples: Teradata, you have Exadata, you have Netezza by IBM, you have Greenplum. So these are all some of the examples of the data appliances that we will make it. So if you go and make a check at Teradata, Teradata big data appliances, now you can get the images. So they are all higher end. Okay, you can have find these are all higher end servers. These are all higher end servers which is used for storing and processing what we called as big data. Okay, the servers have very high capabilities. Okay, now you can find it can scale up to storage up to 12 TB, 186 petabyte, 61 petabyte like thing. So here you have higher end servers with more storage, with more processing capability, which is suited for our big data. Then if we have data appliances, what is the drawback? Why we need to go for other thing? So we have data appliances. And what is the necessity of going for another tool is, here the drawback here that is associated with your data appliances is, here it is of cost. Even though you have a tool by name data appliances, the drawback that is associated with is cost. You need to invest for hardware. If you want to procure the data appliances, you need to invest in terms of crores. And all the softwares that we are using for storing and processing, being it is customized or licensed softwares, you need to pay for that. That's the drawback. If you take into consideration countries like India, developing countries like India, out of 100, nearly 70-80% are either entry level companies or startup companies are coming under mid-level companies. Only 20% of companies are coming under enterprise levels. So it is not a problem for enterprise level companies to invest in terms of crores for this infrastructure establishment. But imagine if you want to invest in terms of crores to set up a infra for storing and processing big data for entry or mid-level company, it is a huge Herculean task. It is not at all affordable for them. Therefore, use of data appliances for storing and processing the data currently that they are having is not a better solution because of the cost. Therefore, but they have data. These sort of 80% of companies, they have the data of big data caliber. But they doesn't possess the needed infra because of its huge investment. Here comes a message from the Apache Open Source Foundation. We have the Apache Open Source Foundation. The Apache Open Source Foundation developed a tool called as Hadoop. We call Hadoop as a framework, which is used for storing and processing what we call as big data. So what is Hadoop? So Hadoop is a framework developed by the Apache Open Source Foundation, and this component has been written using Java as its language. But then here, it supports a massive amount of data. You can able to store huge volume of data. Those data may be structured data, a semi-structured data, or it may be unstructured data. Most importantly, here, what is the problem that it is associated with your data appliances? Cost. Here, you can able to eradicate that. You can store a massive amount of structured, semi-structured, and unstructured data using an inexpensive commodity hardware. That means using a low-cost hardware. You can use your i3 machines, i5 machines, or i7 machines for storing and processing data. You can able to achieve a great performance by using this inexpensive commodity hardware, by using the concept of parallel processing. I can able to do process parallelly. So this is the way by which, by depicting a Hadoop, you can able to store and process big data, which is almost 100 times efficient in terms of performance, also in terms of cost involved compared to that of your data appliances. Okay, so this is Hadoop. Here, the Hadoop is not a single component. Hadoop can be clubbed with multiple components that we will discuss. Now you know what is big data, then what are all the characteristics which makes a data as a big data in terms of volume, in terms of velocity and variety. Now we also discussed about the differences between the RDBMS and big data in terms of architecture. So now we are going to discuss about the database architecture. Okay, the database architecture of RDBMS, you know, it is a centralized database architecture in which all the data will be stored on a single server. Whereas the architecture of your Hadoop is a distributed database architecture. Here you store data across multiple servers. The server where you store data is called as data nodes. You call this node as a data nodes. You have n number of data nodes. So before going into this database architecture, let me discuss about the infra architecture. In terms of the infra, here it is a client server. You have server and you have multiple clients. What is the role of here? The data storage and data processing will take place only on the server. The client simply acts as an interface, that's all. The user will interact with the database through the client. It won't do any data storage or it won't do any data processing. The client, everything will be done on a server. Whereas here, this is a master-slave architecture. Some machines has been designated as masters, some machines has been designated as slaves. We have a machine called name node. We have a machine called secondary name node. We have a machine called job tracker. We have machines called data node. On top of it, we have task tracker. This is the architecture associated with Hadoop version 1.x. Hadoop version 1.x is facing some issues. Those issues has been resolved in Hadoop 2.x, which has its different architecture. Out of the 100 implementation, nearly 60% of implementation is with Hadoop 1.x, and nearly 35 to 37% of implementation is handled with Hadoop 2.x. Only around 3% now they are following Hadoop 3.x, which is the current version, which was a stable version which comes into the market somewhat around 4 to 5 months, within these 4 months. Okay, so here nearly 97% of implementation is with 1.x and 2.x. We will discuss more detail about this, and we have an overview on 3.x. Okay, so this is the architecture. Master slave architecture. You need to configure a node as name node. You need to configure a secondary name node. You need to configure a job tracker. And you will be having multiple data nodes. On top of the data nodes, you want to run the task tracker as a daemon, a background process. So this is the architecture that it is associated with a Hadoop. So in reality, so a Hadoop cluster will contain the following things. You have a name node server, you have a secondary name node, and you have job tracker. These are all servers. Then you have data nodes. Data node 1, data node 2, up to you will be having n data nodes. On top of the data node, you have a process, task tracker 1. We have how many data nodes? That mix of task tracker will be there. Togetherly, everyone will togetherly will form a Hadoop cluster. We call this as a Hadoop cluster. A group of computers here. How the user interface? The user can interact with a node called edge nodes or clients, through which the user will interact with the cluster. Here, these machines are master, these machines are slaves. Here, the data storage and data processing will take place only on these slaves, not on master. The master will do only a control operation. It will control all the data storage and data processing which happens in the slave nodes. Okay? So how many masters? How many slaves? So in your Hadoop 1.x, you can have only one name node, one secondary name node, one job tracker. Here the number of data nodes, you can have n number of data nodes. What? How many data nodes? See, the number of data nodes in a cluster depends upon two factors. One, the volume of data that you need to store in the cluster. Second, the hard disk capacity of your data nodes. These are all the two factors which influences how many data nodes will be there in your cluster. Let me make it with an example. Then you have a what is distributed database. Up to this, you have any doubt, please let me know before proceeding further. So you need to minimum set up the following machines. If it is a Oracle, if it is a RDBMS, you need to have only one server and one client. Okay, through that client you can access. But if you want to set up a Hadoop cluster, you need to have the following computer minimum.
Is a master, you mentioned name node, secondary name node and job tracker. Is it the individual machine or all in a
part individual of machine? Tanithaniyana computer open. Each okay. And everything is a separate computer.
Okay. So on the computer depends on project port, inamari level of the hard disk inamari capacity RAM.
That will be discussed. Okay. Yeah, that will be discussed.
Okay.
Now I want to make you what is the understanding of what is the architecture. இதெல்லாம் இருக்கணும் அப்படிங்கிறது நம்ம இப்போ தெரிஞ்சுக்கிறோம். எவ்வளோ சைஸ் இருக்கணும், ஏன் அவ்வளோ இருக்கணுங்கிறது இட் வில் பி டிஸ்கஸ் இன் டியூ கோர்சஸ்.
ஓகே.
Okay. Now, this is the architecture. Let me discuss about what is distributed database. Here, you have a data. You have, imagine, 10 dB of data. You have a file, one whose size is 10 dB. If it is RDBMS, which is a centralized database, entire 10 dB need to be stored on the single server. The server should have a hard disk of 10 dB. If not, you can store. That is the limitation of RDBMS. Whereas in case of Hadoop, imagine you have a machine with a 2 terabyte of storage capacity. That is your data. So for storing 10 dB, how the 10 dB has been stored? So the 10 dB has been splitted into 2 dB, 2 dB each, and it will be distributed across 5 data nodes. In this scenario, you have data node 1 up to data node 5. Each data node can able to store 2 dB. Therefore, this 10 dB has been splitted into 2, 2, 2, and each data node will be stored with this 2 dB of data. Therefore, your 10 dB has been distributed here across 5 data nodes. In this scenario, the volume of data that you need to store is 10 dB. The hard disk size of your data node is being 2 dB. Therefore, how many data nodes that you need? You need 5 data nodes. If you want to store 20 dB of data, how many data nodes that you need to have? You need to have 10 data nodes. Therefore, the number of data nodes depends upon the following two factors. This is the way by which you can define your data nodes. And these data nodes can be of commodity hardware. You can have your data node configured using an i3, i5, where a small low cost machines. Okay, so this is the difference between a centralized database and a distributed database. Here, the concept here is, if you want to store more data, 30 dB of data, what you need to go for a scaling. What do you mean by scaling? Adding additional resources is called as scaling. So there are two types of scaling. One is horizontal scaling, then another one is vertical scaling. Vertical scaling means you have a machine with 5 TB of storage. If you want to store 10 TB, so you can, within that machine itself, you can add additional 5 TB, therefore your total capacity is 10 TB. So you add resources within that machine, that is called vertical scaling. Instead of that, you have a machine with 5 TB, if you add another machine of 5 TB, so here your 10 TB of data has been splitted and it will be stored across these two machines. This is called horizontal scaling. So Hadoop follows the horizontal scaling architecture. Yes? You no need to worry about the volume of data. If your volume size increases to 50 TB, no need to worry about. You can add data nodes up to 25 data nodes. So that you can go on add your data nodes into your cluster whenever necessity arises. Okay, this is the way by which, without bothering about how much of incoming data, you can create an environment by having more number of data nodes to accommodate some additional data. This concept will make your Hadoop architecture to have a better solution, a cost-effective solution for handling a huge volume of data, which your traditional RDBMS couldn't make sense. Yes, is it clear? What is distributed and what is centralized?
Yeah.
Yes, go. So how it will be distributed, who will distribute, it will be taken care by the name node. Okay, the name node's responsibility is to maintain all the servers in the cluster. The name node's responsibility is to maintain all the computers in the cluster. it contains the metadata information. If a name node dumps, you couldn't do any activity, the cluster will dump. So the name node forms the core component. You can't do any activity. So if a name node dumps, here comes the secondary name node, which helps the name node during its recovery process. We will have a separate discussion of what recovery process will be initiated by the secondary name node during a name node failure. The thing that you want to keep in your mind is the name node maintains all the metadata informations in its RAM memory. Therefore, if a name node dumps, then RAM, being it is a volatile memory, the metadata informations also will be erased. Okay, if a name node recovers, the metadata information, being it is erased, it doesn't know the status of the cluster. At that time, the secondary name node, what it will do, it will maintain a copy of the metadata. Then it will make the copy available in the name node RAM memory during its recovery process. That is the help done by the secondary name node. We will have deep discussions in the forthcoming classes. As of now, the secondary name node will assist name node during recovery process. And we have job tracker, which takes care of executing all the user submitted jobs. If a user wants to do some process, a job tracker will take care of all those things. These are all the functions of name node. Your data node is used for storing data and for processing data. How it stores data? Under the control of name node. Name node will decide under which data node data need to be stored. Name node decide under which data node it need to be processed. How it will do the storage and how it will do the processing will be discussed. Okay, so these are all the functions associated with name node, secondary name node, job tracker and data nodes. Hadoop is not a single environment. It is a combination of several things. So we have in our Hadoop the following infra. We have a name node, we have a secondary name node, we have a job tracker under which we have multiple data nodes. We have data node 1, we have data node 2, we have n number of data nodes. Here, these are all the data sources. The data sources may be a RDBMS data source. It may be a ETL data. It may be a data warehouse. Or it may be a normal text data, a text file, raw data. It may be a sensor data. Okay, it may be data from Facebook or Twitter, whatever may be. These are all various data sources. You need some tools, data crawling tools, data fetch tools. Here the tools we are going to make use of is Scoop, Flume, Kafka, Niffy. These are all the prominently used tools. Here our curriculum deals with Scoop and Flume. Okay, for gathering RDBMS we use Scoop. For gathering ETL, for gathering sensors, all other things we go for Flume. This Kafka and Niffy are for gathering and streaming data. It fetches the data and places the data into your Hadoop file system, in your data nodes. And we can do process using other tools, like we have tools like Hive, we have tools like Pip. They are data processing tools. If you have your data here in data node, you need to write a model called MapReduce program. This MapReduce can be written using Java, Python, Perl, etc. It will be complicated if you write a MapReduce coding in Java or Python. For example, if your code is running into 100 lines, the same thing can be completed within 10 lines if it is a Hive or Pip. That's much of powerful and Hive and Pip. They are all data processing tools. Okay, they are all data crawling tools. We have databases. To store data, we have databases. Like we have HBase, we have MongoDB, we have Cassandra, they are all databases for storing and processing big data. To coordinate all the things, we have a coordinator called the zookeeper. Okay, you have a coordinator called zookeeper. Similarly, you have several tools. All the tools here, our curriculum deals with Scoop, Flume, Hive and Peak, and we configure this Hadoop cluster. And apart from that, so here this is a programming model. So instead of programming model, we follow another model which is called Apache Spark, in-memory data processing. This is a framework which is which we call in-memory data processing. Which is found to be 100 times faster than Hadoop. Apache Spark. How we will discuss. So these are all the tools. We call this as a ecosystem components associated with the Hadoop framework. So with this, we can come to the end of today's discussion. Being it is an overview as of our previous plan. So we have started with the following agenda of introduction to big data. Big data with RDBMS, Hadoop architecture in terms of infra and terms of database, and Hadoop ecosystems. We will make it more clarity with appropriate examples, how to what sort of data that we will be using, what sort of analysis that we will be performing in the coming Saturday session. Is it clear what we have discussed so far? Can you make a sense of what we need to do here? Because we need to go up with this n number of machines. Instead, here we are many companies. Instead of establishing this physical server, they are getting the resources from cloud. Therefore, a combination of cloud with Hadoop administrator is one of the most demanding stuff today IT industry is looking for. In cloud, you can able to perform adding the resources within a minute. If you compare to adding a physical server, it took days to procure a server, to assemble a server, to install the needed applications, operating systems, and to connect the server with the cluster. So if you use cloud, you can add the server into the cluster within a minute. That is the advantage going for cloud. And you no need to worry about whenever you have more data, you can go and launch additional servers. Whenever your data size is less, you can release the underutilized resources. Because of the less cost in establishing the infra, and because of the less effort needed for management, here majority of the Hadoop implementation is with cloud. Therefore, a combination of cloud with Hadoop was found to be one of the most demanding thing in IT. So we will discuss all those things, how to set up a cluster using your cloud, how to set up your cluster using your virtual machines, softwares like VMware will be discussed in our due courses. If you have any doubt with respect to what we have discussed, please let me know. Radha, Prabhu, Sindhu, Sudhakar.
Yeah, here just a question, maybe here, number eight, and then MapReduce. When we go for MapReduce, and as you said, MapReduce, we need to write a lot of codes and complexities are there, and better to use Hive and Peak. So, in which scenarios usually we go for MapReduce and data processing tools?
That's it. You, I'm not sure. I will discuss with an example, a basic scenario. என்ன நீங்கள் அனாலிசிஸ் பண்ணுவீங்க, ஒரு ரியல் டைம் எக்ஸாம்பிள் வச்சு நான் உங்களுக்கு அடுத்த கிளாஸ்லேயே
சொல்லிடுவேன்.
இல்லை என்ன காம்ப்ளெக்ஸிட்டி
ரெக்கார்டிங், அப்புறம் இந்த ரெக்கார்டிங் வீடியோஸ் எல்லாம் எப்படி இருக்கும்னு நம்ம இதை பார்க்கணும்னா
யூடியூப்பில் நான் உங்களுக்கு ஒரு லிங்க் கொடுத்துருவேன், அதுலேருந்து நீங்கள் எப்போனாலும் அதை பார்த்துக்கலாம். நீங்கள் உங்களுக்கு
ஓகே இது எபோட் த டேட்டா நோட் நீங்கள் சொன்னீங்க எக்ஸாம்பிள்
ரியல் டைமில்
பிளாக்
பை பிளாக்காக இருக்கும் எப்படி அப்படிங்கிறது நம்ம பார்த்துருவோம். ஓகே, கொஞ்சம் இது எல்லாத்தையும் கன்வெர்ட் பண்ணி உங்களுக்கு நான் நைட்டுக்குள்ளே அப்டேட் பண்ணி. எனி அதர் டவுட்?
நெக்ஸ்ட் வீக் இதே லிங்க் தானே இல்லை வேற லிங்க் ஏதாச்சும்?
இல்லை ஒவ்வொரு வாரமும் தனித்தனி லிங்க் ஆனும்.
ஓகே, ஒவ்வொரு லிங்க்கும்
செப்பரேட் செப்பரேட் லிங்க்.
ஓகே, ஐ திங்க் ராதாவோட இமெயில் ஐடி இஸ் ராங் நினைக்கிறேன். அது
என்னுடைய மெயிலுக்கு ரெண்டு பேர் ஒரு இது மட்டும் அனுப்பிச்சு விட்டுருங்க, கரெக்ட் மெயில் ஐடி அனுப்பிச்சு விட்டுருங்க.
ஓகே
ஓகே.